So hello everyone, welcome to the next session on ABAP on HANA. In today's session, we will start with SQL scripts. Before we start SQL script, we need to understand what is the difference between scripting language and procedural language. So this question comes in our mind, and whenever we see there are people who are talking about scripting like JavaScripting, shell scripting, SQL scripting. So what is a script? And what is a programming language like Java or C or C++ or ABAP? These are all the programming languages. So what is the difference between procedural, which is also known as scripting language, versus programming language? This is a very good interview question also. If sometime the interviewer wants to get deep into your interview, this is the kind of question which interviewer can ask you. What is the difference between programming language and scripting language? So what is a programming language? So programming language are independent products. Okay, they are independent products. And they generate their own runtimes. Own executables. For example, when you compile a Java class, .class file gets converted to .java file gets converted to .class. So .class is the executable which Java gives. Similarly, when you create a C program and compile using C, .exe in the Windows get created. So these are all their own executable with these programming languages produces. So code is compiled and it generates the machine code basically. So code is compiled by programming language. And converted to machine code or operating system code, which operating system can understand. Okay, so for example, Java is a programming language. So when you compile a .java file, it creates a machine file which machine or operating system can understand. Your basically your JDK will understand this file, which is equal to a .class file. So that's what the programming language is. Now, what is a scripting language or what is a procedural language? So the scripting language are not independent products. They are actually parasite. Again, in biology, when we used to learn biology, we know what is a parasite. So parasite are the bacteria which relies on the food cooked by host. They don't cook their food on their own. So scripting language are exactly the parasites. So they don't exist independently. They are built or they are generated. Their runtime is built on top of existing programming language. Okay. So scripting languages are embedded on programming languages. Okay, they are embedded on programming languages. They are embedded on programming languages. They are embedded on programming languages. Now, for example, they rely on. And what exactly happens when you write a scripting code? It is never compiled. It is actually interpreted. There is an interpreter which converts this code into something which programming language understands. And then finally, programming language compiles it and puts it to the near to the operating system. So they rely on the APIs. APIs of programming language. For example, in Microsoft, you have MS Office. It's built using C, C++. So we all use MS Office, PowerPoint, Excel. And in Excel, we have then scripting language. You can use VB script in Excel as a programming scripting language, which is then later point of time using C only behind the scenes. So it's built on top of your existing programming languages. So they are basically works as an extension to the programming language. They consume the API. It's another facade layer on existing programming language. That's what scripting languages are. Okay. Now, if you talk about scripting language in SAP HANA, we have SQL scripting. SQL scripting is also a procedural language. What is the advantage of using SQL scripting? Why we use SQL script? So advantage comes when you understand disadvantage of existing approach. So what is the disadvantage of your HANA views you have learned by far in the previous chapters? So in HANA, we have learned information models like attribute views, analytical views, calculation views. What is the disadvantage of views? Anybody? What is the disadvantage of views? What is the disadvantage of using views? Create proxies. No, create proxy is disadvantage when you compare it with respect to ABAP. So when it comes to ABAP, then it's a disadvantage. Okay, then it's a disadvantage. What else? What do you think? In terms of database, what is the disadvantage of using views? What is the disadvantage? Second DB in HANA views. It can't be debugged, correct? So that's the first disadvantage. You cannot debug a view. Correct, you're right. You cannot debug a view. What else? When it comes to decomposing complex logic, you cannot do it with SQL views. Or if you also compare it with queries, SQL queries, you would find a lot of disadvantages. So when it comes to complex decomposing, complex logic, business logic, so these views are not sufficient because intermediate results from the views cannot be stored. You can't store the intermediate results. For example, you have the data foundation created with two tables that produces some data. Can you store that data somewhere in database? You cannot. You have to use that further on in a join, in a union, or in an operation. And whatever you add finally as a measure or attribute is what you see. You don't have a possibility to store the intermediate results from the view or do some calculation on the intermediate results. Okay. The second disadvantage, you don't have possibility in HANA to express business logic. No possibility to express business logic like if condition, else condition, case statement, looping. All these things are not possible when it comes to SQL queries and views. Okay, it is not possible to do ifs and buts. Business, real true business logic, not possible. SQL queries can only return one value and has no chaining. Suppose you want to give output of one query to input of another query. You can do subqueries, but out of the output of subquery, you want to give partial input to another query. You cannot do it. Okay. Partial input, let's say you got five columns, and out of those five columns, only three columns you want to give it to next query. You cannot do that. They can only return one complete set which you have to consume at it as it is. Otherwise, you have to write same query multiple times on same table with different set of selections in the column. Now, next important thing is imperative logic. as I mentioned, the looping, if, buts, case statements, calling reusable modules, all that you can't do it. Like you saw just now in our previous example of decision table, in SAP HANA, when we create a decision table for planning scenario, we cannot directly look at a data preview. We cannot consume it in a SQL query. We have to consume the procedure which has been created. Correct? That's what is the problem with the HANA queries or HANA views. So what is the solution for these problems? The solution of this problem is using SQL scripting language. This is not something new in the industry. It's there since years. SQL script is considered to be one of the best technique to do a code push down to the database layer. But by far, without SAP HANA, the databases were not that powerful. With SAP HANA, it was made possible to have hardware and software innovations, which we discussed in previous classes, to achieve fast computations with the help of parallelization. Because you're using multi-core CPUs and all the data kept in the RAM, you can do a fast computation using SQL script. So what exactly, from the interview point of view, you will answer when somebody asks you SQL script? So if you're going for an interview, if somebody asks you what is SQL script, what will be your answer? What is SQL script? The answer is very simple. SQL script is a collection of extension to SQL. Okay. SQL script is a collection of extension to SQL. So your SQL includes all the variety of statements, DML, DDL, DQL, okay, DCL. All we have discussed in the previous classes. If you remember, in one of the session, I have explained you about the core database. So this is the joint class which we had. We had discussed about all the different variety of statements which we typically use in a SQL query or in a database, DDL, DML, all these things we had discussed in the past. Correct? So that's what exactly happens here. So it's an extension to current SQL. Okay, it's an extension to that, extension to current SQL. Now, what is this extension is useful for? It allows to us to develop code intensive logic in the database. So it allows developer to write performance intensive logic inside database. So we saw the technique of information model to do a code push down like currency conversion. Similarly, if you want to do some more business logic calculation directly into the database, you can definitely use SQL script because it gives you all those capabilities what your ABAP gives you. In ABAP, you have ifs and buts and loops and stuff. All that you can do directly in the database using SQL script. Okay. So all the data intensive logic or performance intensive logic can be coded directly inside the database using SQL script. Okay. And that's what SQL script is all about in SAP HANA. And this is one of the technique used in code to data paradigm, which we discussed in the past. Okay. So what exactly SQL script helps you? It helps you to write imperative logic. It helps you to collect intermediate results into variables, transfer the output of one query to the input of another query. All that is possible using SQL script. Now, how the system runs SQL script? What happens behind the scenes when you run a SQL script in the system? So how the system processes SQL script? What are all the phases? The first thing what HANA database does is it will parse your SQL statement and detect if there is any syntax error. So the first step is parsing the statement and detect and report the syntax error. Okay, this is the first step when you submit your SQL script code block to the SAP HANA database. Once this is fine, you don't have a syntax error, what you've written is syntactically fine. What SAP HANA database does is does the next stuff. What's the next stuff? It basically, let me connect these arrows. Okay, so it checks the statement semantics and derived types. So what is derived types? Okay, I will explain you. There are two ways you can create types in SAP HANA SQL script. One is derived types. One is explicitly typed types. Basically, the way you create variables. So one way is you create a variable by declaring it and providing exact data type. Another is you directly assign your output to a variable and then it will be automatically created as a derived type. Okay, we will discuss about it in our next discussion. And then finally, SAP HANA optimizes the code. Okay, it optimizes the SQL code. Okay, so that's the beauty of our calculation engine in SAP HANA. It optimizes the code. And if you remember our discussion of calculation engine, that's what exactly we saw in the architecture of our calculation engine. So you have this model optimizer, SQL script compiler, model optimizer, intermediate result, executor, and then you have operators, database optimizer, SQL script optimizer. So it will give it to SQL script optimizer to optimize your SQL statement. Okay. Now there are two types of logic what you can write, or there are two variety of SQL script logic you can write in SAP HANA. There are two broad categories. So whenever you're working with SQL script, there are two types of logic or statements you write in SQL script. What are all those two types? The first type of statement are declarative logic. Declarative logic is also known as data flow logic, which is nothing but pure SQL, like insert, read, update, select statement. That is pure SQL commands. The second type of logic which you include is imperative logic, which includes your if statement, but else, case, looping, all that, the variable declaration, all that is your imperative logic in SAP HANA. Okay. Now, this is also known as orchestration logic. Orchestration logic, which is nothing but your flow, how you're building a business logic, basically, orchestration logic with all the if conditions, case statements, and loopings. Now, when you run and give these two types of statements to SAP HANA, SAP HANA identifies the category of your statement. Suppose you written an if condition. Now, can anybody tell me if I write an if condition, which category of statement it goes to? Anyone? Which category of statement it goes to? Category 1 or category 2? Anyone? So Shilpa says category 2. Perfect answer. It goes to this category. If I write select star from SNWD underscore PD table, which category it goes to? Select star from SNWD PD table, which is our product table in EPM model. It goes to category 1. Perfect. So HANA separates out all your imperative logic and declarative logic in separate blocks. It categorizes it. And the declarative logic, which is your data flow logic, gets converted to a data flow graph. Okay. So HANA converts this to a data flow graph. Do you know why it does convert it to a data flow graph? Any reason? Anybody? Can you guess why? Parallelization. That's the reason why it converts your logic to a data flow graph, a set of SQL statements which can be executed in parallel. And that is also defined as a query plan. Okay, that is defined as a query plan, where HANA determines which SQL statements I can execute in parallel, which one I cannot. That's why it converts your declarative or data flow logic into a query, into a data flow graph. So let me take an example here to show you a sample graph. Suppose I write, okay, I'm writing some pseudocode, not writing true pure SQL script. We will discuss about syntax of SQL script in a minute. That time you will start understanding this code. So say I will create a variable, say my LT underscore Anubhav, and I will say select star from SNWD underscore product table. Okay. So I've got the product, all the product columns in this variable LT Anubhav, local table Anubhav. Okay. Now what I'll do is I will call another statement where I will say select, and I will say LT products or LT sales orders. And let's say in the first query, I will say, get me the product where the price is more than $1,000. Okay. And then I will get the orders, select star from order table, where product ID used in the order in, and then a subquery, select product ID from my variable LT Anubhav. Okay, so in my LT Anubhav, I have all the products which has MRP more than 1000, and I'm using this variable here in my second query. This is your query two. Okay, this is your query one. Okay, now I write another query, and I will say LT purchase orders equals to select star from purchase orders, where product ID, again the same thing, almost same thing, same logic comes here. The product ID is this, and this is my query 3. And then I will finally say select sum of gross amount from LT sales order. I'm basically totaling up all the amount which I've got from the sales order table. So I have these four queries written in my logic. Can anybody tell me what type of logic you will categorize it? Is there any imperative logic in this? Or is this pure declarative logic? Anybody? What type of logic category you will put this? All the entire set of statement. Pure one, correct? Because it doesn't have any ifs and buts. It has only and only your SQL statements. Okay. Then when you give this to SAP HANA, it creates a data flow graph for this. What it does, it evaluates that can you run some piece of query in parallel. So anybody, can you guess and tell me which are all the queries which can be executed in parallel by SAP HANA? And which queries are dependent on each other? 2 and 3. Perfect answer, Shilpa. See, look at the query. The first query cannot run in parallel because it is the starting point. So let's say you put query 1 here. This is the start. Okay. Now you see query number 2 is using the first query output. So until my first query gets over, I can't use its input. Okay. Until my first query Anubhav is evaluated, I can't use it anywhere, correct? So my second query is dependent on first query output. So then I will put query 2 over here. This is my query 2. So it has to be output of first query is going in the input of second query. So it has to go sequentially. It cannot run, both cannot run in parallel. Now query 3, is the query 3 input dependent on the output of query 2? Anyone? Do you depend in query 3 with an output of query 2? No, you cannot. Do you depend with the output of query 1 in query 3? Do you depend? Yes, you can see LT Anubhav. Output of query 1 is going to the input of query 3. So it's dependent. So After my query 1 is executed, then only I should run query 3. But since 2 and 3 are not dependent on each other, I can run them in parallel. That's my query 3. So both of these queries runs in parallel. Okay. Now my final query. My query 4, is this dependent on 1? Of course not. Is this dependent on 2? Anybody? Is my query 4 dependent on query 2? Yes or no? Yes, it is. You can see that the output here, LT sales order, is given as an input to my query 4. So it's dependent. This is output. It's given here and it's given here. So these query 2 and 3 are dependent on 1. Output of query 2 is given to query 4. So it's dependent on query 2. Okay. So then if I just try to draw this data flow graph, I would say my query 4 is dependent on the output of query 2. So this is my query 4 and is dependent on the output of query 2. And then final result is actually like this. So any parallel branch you see can be executed by a multi-core processor. One core processes this part, this branch, another core processes this branch. At the end of the result is combined and shown it to the business user finally. That's called parallelization using multi-core CPU in SAP HANA. That's how it runs your data flow graphs or declarative logic. Okay. So what is the rule of the game? This is also an interesting interview question. When you're going for interview, people may ask you, or if I'm interviewer, anyways, I'm going to ask you this question. What are all the rule of the game that SAP HANA comes out of parallel mode? So as long as you have declarative logic like this, it has a parallelization operation. Okay. It will do some parallelization if possible based on your definitions. But what are all the rule of the game? If you break those rules, HANA comes out of parallel mode automatically. What are all the rules of the game when HANA comes out of parallel mode? Comes out of. See guys, my intention is not just to teach you the programming, but also teach you behind the scenes what is happening. Because then only you can crack an interview. You need to understand database functionality from the depth so you can write optimized code. Otherwise, even you do code push down, you are not going to get significant results when you remove your code from ABAP and do a code push down to your database. Whatever you like, you do it. It doesn't matter if you do not apply these concepts properly. Like if you don't follow SQL guidelines, which I have already explained you in the past. Like you should have minimized data set results, number of calls to database, amount of data transfer between application, and all this we had discussed in the past. So these are all the rule of the game, which you should always remember when you're coding. Okay. It's not like I have removed the business logic from ABAP and I put it in a HANA procedure and now, wow, I will get performance improvement. No, it can even go worse because you may violate these things. You may violate some of the rules which will act anti-HANA rules actually. It will not leverage the power of HANA, but it will act enemy for SAP HANA DB. It will become worse, like select star. You know, it's a column store. Doing select star is very expensive. When it comes to row store, select star is more optimal. So you should not do select star, right? Some of these rules which we already discussed in the past. Okay. So select statements. I will take questions in a minute, guys. Please hold on. Are executed in SAP HANA in parallel unless, what are all the rules? First rule of the game, local scalar parameters and variables are used in container. Okay. Now what is container here? I will talk about container blocks in a minute when we will move to SQL script. So there are three types of containers. You can consider it as a procedure. Reusable, executable SQL script block. Okay. So whenever you use local scalar parameters and variables, you are coming out of parallel mode. Okay, again, further, it will not switch back to the parallel mode. So if you're writing a pure declarative logic in SAP HANA procedure, then only it have a chance to run in parallel mode. The moment you use a control flow logic, if statement, but statement, case statement, anything if you use, it comes out of parallel mode immediately. Okay. Second, read write procedure. Basically, TDL or DML statement are executed. The moment you say create table, it's a DDL command. System comes out of parallel mode. You say insert into table, comes out of parallel mode. It won't execute in parallel mode. It will just execute in a sequential mode. It will switch to sequential mode. Okay. So make sure you're writing all select queries together without using scalar variable parameters within the procedure. It will run in parallel. Third condition, imperative logic is used. And you all know it's if, case, loop, all that is imperative logic. The moment you use it, system comes out of parallel mode. It won't switch back. Okay. SQL statements which are not assigned to variable. So here you see in our example, we are assigning every output to a variable here. You see, we are assigning to a variable actually. So when you do this, your parallel mode works. The moment you write a pure query, it comes out of parallel mode. Okay. So HANA optimizes your SQL procedural logic. Okay. Declarative logic into data flow graphs and see if it can be executed in parallel. Remember, your procedure or your block should be declared only built with declarative logic. The moment you include an imperative logic, it will not run in parallel mode. The moment it encounters a statement which is using imperative logic, it will come out of parallel mode. And that's why I told you, use CE functions in SAP HANA. Calculation engine functions, because that's pure that is built pure declarative logic. And it also doesn't have to switch back between the SQL optimizer and calculation engine. Hence, you would get better performance. Okay. Hope you will remember these rules of the game. If asked in interview, your answer should be this. Okay. Now, there's a question from Bhaskar. Do you think same modeling is used to build marketing graphical modelers? I didn't get you this question, Bhaskar. I'm not sure what do you mean by marketing graphical modelers, but I can tell you the concept which is used in information model, what we had built here in the system. So if you remember, we had built all our calculation views, attribute views, analytical views. So all that is nothing but data flow graphs. Okay. Those are actually data flow graphs. Whatever we have done here in the sales package, they are all data flow graphs actually we have created. Okay. Now, moving on. So let's look at the programming now with SQL script. So any programming, we all know, whether it is ABAP, Java, C, C++, we are all programmers. We all know the basic stuff every programming language has. It has variables, it has types. So we will discuss about the types in SQL script. So majorly, there are three categories of types in SAP HANA SQL script. So now we are jumping to the SQL script directly and going to write some piece of code using SQL script. So what are all the different three types we have in SAP HANA? So we have scalar variables, scalar types, which are nothing but your simple one value variable. Okay. In a normal programming, this is a fancy name of a normal variable which can hold one value at a time. Then we have table types. Okay, and then you have array types. So what is the difference between table and array? A table is actually a collection of variety of columns. It can have variety of columns like integer, varchars, dates, big integer, decimal. It can have variety of columns. But array always and always have one type of column. It's a single column table actually. One type of column, whatever you have, you can do it. So these are all the three types of variables, variable types majorly used in SQL script. And then we have the data types. So there are different data types in SAP HANA, which I will show you. Like in SAP ABAP, in data dictionary, you have char, string, all these are different data types. You have it. Similarly, in SAP HANA, we have different primitive data types. These are called primitive data types, which your SQL script supports. Data types. So we have for numeric values, different data types like tiny int, tiny integer, small integer, integer, big integer, decimal for decimal values, small decimal, double for large values. Then for character data type, we have in SAP HANA varchar, variable character. You can also give the size in this, like this, parenthesis and the size of the variable character. You have n varchar, where you have a combination of character with number, n varchar. You have alphanumeric, alphanum, okay, for hexadecimal numbers and stuff like that. Then you have date-related, date and time-related data types, primitive data types, like timestamp and date time, which we use. Then we have a binary types. So that is also used for GUIDs, so-called your GUIDs for your SNWD tables, var binary. Okay. And then you have also the large object like storing an image. So large object types in SAP HANA, CLOB, BLOB, binary, LOB, BLOB, CLOB, NLOB, number, LOB. So all that we have it. So basically, these are all the primitive data types in SAP HANA. So how do you create a scalar variable? Now, before we get into scalar variable, let's talk about containers in SAP HANA. So what is a container? What is the data, logic container in SAP HANA or SQL script? So logic container are actually the blocks to, or placeholders where you write all your coding. So what is container in SAP HANA? So containers are blocks in which we write the imperative or declarative. Okay, your imperative logic, your declarative logic, all that is written inside these blocks. Okay, there are three variety of blocks in SAP HANA in total. So one is called anonymous blocks, which doesn't have any name. Okay, anonymous blocks. Then you have procedures. And then you have user defined functions, UDFs. We also call them UDFs. Okay. These are all the three types of containers we have in SAP HANA, in which you will be writing your code. Guys, I have seen a lot of videos of different trainers. They don't even talk about them. Trainers don't even talk about these things actually. What they will typically start is directly procedures. According to majority of the trainings and trainers I've seen, they only talk about procedures. But when you go to interview, if the interviewer asks you what is the container and what are all the types of containers, you don't have an answer. Procedure is just one of the type of container. I have seen trainers with a lot of experience, they don't even know or they don't even talk about these things. How will you face an interview? How will you face an interview in such case? It feels so depressing many times that people are taking classes One class I have seen, one trainer have taken 1 hour class on while loop, 1 hour class on if loop, if while loop and loop, three classes SQL script completed. Trainer, don't even talk about containers, anonymous blocks, procedures, and one class with import export parameter. Yeah, 4 to 5 classes hardly has taken and completed SQL script. Very bad, very, very bad. Never learn from these type of trainers. They don't have complete knowledge. What they typically do, they will just get some reference from internet, from blogs. They will copy that code, put it. They will paste and demo you that we are teaching SQL script. They are not even teaching even 5% of SQL script actually. They are cheating. Never go with such trainers. Okay. Anonymous block, procedural blocks, and user-defined blocks. Let me quickly write down the syntax for all three of them. The anonymous block is written using do, begin, okay, and then we have end. This is how you declare an anonymous block. As the name suggests, it doesn't have a name. Okay, what is the problem with anonymous block? You cannot reuse. Okay, this is the biggest problem of it. You cannot reuse. Second biggest problem with this is it compiles every time. So it does first the compilation step and then it executes it. Okay, that's where anonymous block comes into picture. What is this, the application for anonymous block? If you want to run some piece of logic for training purpose or just for trial purpose or once in a lifetime, okay, you can do it using anonymous block. You don't need to store it in database. You want to run it only once in a lifetime, or you're just trying something in the system and see if it works, if it gives you some improvement, or if you want to test something, we can use anonymous blocks. So they are mainly used for testing the logic or trial purpose, training purpose, or once in a lifetime purpose. If you want to just execute some processing logic once in a lifetime, you don't want to store it in a compiled format, you can use anonymous blocks. The second type of container comes is procedures. The syntax to create procedure is create procedure. Okay, I'm not writing all the variations of creating procedure, just writing very simple basic syntax so at least you guys get some feel. So procedure name, I'm writing something which you will give in the stereo symbol and in small letters. Something which is a keyword, I'm writing in capital letter. Okay. Then you can give parameters. So you should use in for input parameters. So parameter name. And then you have to put the variable type. Type of the variable, it is integer, character, whatsoever you want to give. You will use out parameters, parameter name. Again, you will use the type of the parameter type, basically. I should also enclose my parameter name as the rule of the game inside the stereo symbol. So this is something you got to give it. Okay. And that's how you give procedure parameters in the parentheses. So create procedure, parameters, then you will put language. Okay. In the language, you have to give the language type. There are two types of languages supported in SAP HANA. And these options are SQL script and R language. R language type. R language type in SAP HANA is used for machine learning purpose, machine learning algorithms. Okay. SQL script is mainly used for ABAP on HANA when you want to do a code pushdown using SQL script. Okay. We will be talking here not R language in this course. You can access the discussion about R language in my next course on machine learning on SAP HANA AFL and PAL. Okay, here in this course we will not talk about it. We will only look at SQL script type. Okay, you can specify default schema for your procedure where the procedure will be saved. That you can specify default schema. And then you have to put a special character called reads SQL data. This will make SAP HANA procedure as a read-only procedure. Okay, what is a read-only procedure? A read-only procedure indicates SAP HANA database that this procedure we are not going to fire any DDL or DML command like insert, update, delete, create table, alter table, drop table. We're not going to do that. It's a read-only procedure. So HANA can apply parallelization, point one. Point two, HANA can also restrict a person calling any insert, update, delete, or DML command. By mistake, if somebody wrote some DML command which modifies the database, then it's risky. So this statement prevents, it gives you error if you're writing any DML command in DB. Then comes is begin statement, and you will start your block, and you end your block with the end statement. Additionally, we also have exception handling in all three types of blocks. I will discuss that in the detail when we start the logic in the system. So that's your create procedure statement in SAP HANA. The create function is absolutely same as procedure. Instead of procedure, just put function. That's it. Now you will ask me, Anubhav, then what is the difference between user-defined function and procedures? There are a lot of differences. When we learn about both of them, I will explain you. Okay. This is a very important interview question also. When you are coming for interview, if I am your interviewer, I will 100% ask you this question. What is the difference between procedure and user-defined functions in SAP HANA or any database for that matter? I am Oracle certified. I have done my Oracle SQL and PL SQL certification or Oracle 10G. So this was one of my favorite questions when I was appearing for certification exam. The difference between procedure and functions in database. So these concepts are database concepts, guys. They are not only relevant for HANA. Syntax may be different, but concept remains same. In database, we have concepts like triggers also. System triggers, we have concept like cursors. We will explain, I will talk about cursors in next class. So you will learn about cursors. How can you use cursor to traverse to the data in the table? Cursors are actually work as a pointer on the data records in database table. We'll discuss about them in detail in upcoming chapter. Okay, so that's the syntax for creating containers in SAP HANA. So we will start with the anonymous block. Even just for information, you also have parameters for anonymous block. You can give parameters. I forgot to mention that. You can have in and out parameters. So parameter name and parameter, same syntax, parameter name, whatever you like to give, and parameter type you can give. And then you have to put equals to greater than symbol to pass the value of the parameter. If you want to pass it from console or take it from console, you can actually pass the value. You can pass hard-coded value, let's say 10, 20, whatever. Or you can put question mark to take the value from console. We will see this in a minute in the system when I will write some piece of code. And then you can have parameter name. And then you can have type. And then you can say question mark. This is true SQL script. This is true SQL script, guys. What you see on YouTube, I am ashamed of that. I have seen many videos. One video only on while loop. 1 hour trainer is only teaching while loop. That's nonsense. It's not SQL script. While loop is not SQL script. This is true SQL script. How the containers are built, how will they behave, and difference between each type of container. This is true SQL script. Okay, time for some funda foxes in SQL script. As we all do, I always do in my trainings, funda foxes are statements which you should remember. And if you remember them, you will never do mistakes. Funda fox. So when we declare variables in SAP HANA SQL script, these variables are initialized with null value. Okay, remember guys, these variables are initialized with null value. We can explicitly assign value during creation also. This is an important statement which will help you. You will understand the meaning of it in a minute when we will move on. Okay, I will show you an example where it makes sense for you to understand. That's our first funda fox about this. The second funda fox, when we create a variable or when we want to use a variable in SAP HANA SQL script, we use symbol colon. Colon symbol will be using, oops, okay, smiley have come. Okay, so we will use colon symbol to refer the variable. Okay, an example. Let me show you an example. So I declare a variable, let's say declare, and say x integer. And now if I want to use x somewhere, okay, I will be using colon x. Okay, if I want to use this value of the variable, I use this special symbol colon x should be used to refer value of x. But when we want to assign value to x, we don't use colon. This is a very important funda fox, and majority of the people fails understanding this funda fox, and that's why they are unable to learn SQL script. Okay, it's a very important funda fox. Okay, hope you remember funda fox in Fury classes, which we have discussed in Fury, were very, very helpful for us. Okay, what next? SQL script is case insensitive, just like your ABAP. You can write capital X, small x, doesn't matter. Unlike JavaScript, which we learned in Fury, it was case sensitive. Here it is not. Clear to all of you, funda foxes? Are we ready to shoot our first SQL block in the system, in our HANA database? Let's go ahead and create a very simple anonymous SQL block in the system. So I will come back to our SAP HANA database. So a lot of people are asking me, Anubhav, where will you give me ABAP on HANA server access? Wanted to tell you that this is a CAL server. Those who are joining class for the first time, remember, it's a CAL server. It's running on SAP CAL, Cloud Application Library. You can set up this server yourself. You don't need to buy the server from anywhere. And I have already covered a video about how to set up your ABAP on HANA server yourself and connect it from the local HANA Studio and SAP GUI. This is already covered. Please look at the previous videos. You will get your answer about the server. Okay, those who are joining for the first time. Okay, there's a question from Bhaskar. Are you starting ML? Not right now, Bhaskar. ML will be started later. I'm preparing for ML right now. I'm learning ML algorithms. Like we have different algorithms, gradient descent. You have linear regression algorithms, linear regression with multiple values, multiple variants. There are different algorithms in machine learning. I'm learning them right now. You see this SysAFL. This is the schema which contains all the machine learning procedures built in with SAP HANA. So when we work with machine learning in SAP HANA, we use SysAFL schema in SAP HANA. Okay, so not the right forum here to discuss about ML. Okay, and once I started training, you will get to know anyways. Great, so let's move on quickly. And now what we're going to do is we're going to write a first anonymous SQL block because it's for training purpose, and I'm going to put all the SQL statements in this text file, guys. So later point of time, you can copy paste these blocks in your HANA Studio and you can try yourself, because this will be really helpful. Okay, now let's start with our first SQL block. So the first which I'm going to do is basic anonymous block. Okay, let me just show you. So do begin. It's not necessary to write begin in a new line. Do begin and end. Now another important funda fox which I missed it. Every SQL statement, okay, every SQL script statement must end with semicolon. Okay, semicolon. That's another funda fox. In ABAP, can anybody tell me in ABAP programming, what is the statement or what is the symbol which we use to end with our ABAP statement? Perfect answer, Deep. It's dot statement, correct. Similarly, in here, we use semicolon to end a statement. Let's write a very simple block here. I'm just going to calculate A plus B. So let me declare a variable A, integer equals to, let's say, 10. Declare B, integer equals to 20. Declare C, integer. And C equals to, now can anybody tell me if I want to refer a variable value, which symbol I will use to refer a variable in SQL script? Perfect answer, Charu. If you guys forget it, remember smiley. You smile if you forget this, you will get to know the smiley symbol. Eyes, remember eyes symbol, smiley, eyes of smiley. That's the symbol to refer if you forget it. Okay, so smiley. Okay, sorry, smiley B. Now you see, if I'm assigning a value, I don't have to use smiley. In this case, C is a variable. I'm assigning the value, I am not using smiley. But if I'm referring a variable, I'm using smiley. Remember this. Okay, so that's your code. Let's execute and we will see some execution happening below. It will show you that it got executed. You can see here it got executed. Zero row affected in database. There is no database operation here. And you can see it got executed. But now you may be wondering, Anubhav, I didn't get output here. It didn't display the output. Of course it won't, because you have to define a parameter to display the output. So how do you do it? Let's define here on the top. Now, one more funda fox, after do statement, put a space to define parameters. Don't immediately start this like this. If you do it, it will fail. You need to be little careful with these small funda fox. So if I directly start parenthesis, put variable C, integer, and I will say the system that show me the output on the console, question mark I will use to show the output on the console. I don't now have to declare this C inside and save this. Let me execute this, you will get an error. I execute, you can see it's giving me an error. It's telling me also the line number where the error is, line number 1, column number 1, with this symbol, syntax error with this symbol. It has to have a space. You see, HANA Studio is also telling me here what is the problem in this line. So just put a space. Remember, your parenthesis should start after space. Okay, let's execute this now. 10 and 20, what will be the result, anybody? 10 and 20, what will be the result for C? Anyone? 10 and 20, what will be the result? 30. Let's execute. Oops, again, there is some error. You see, it's showing some error. Do C integer equals to this? Do I need? Okay, here I'm assigning a value. Do I need to see? You see. No space. No, no, no. This is not a problem. Since I'm referring this variable, I have to use now C. So I'm assigning, but I'm referring, no. Then what's the problem? SQL syntax error near this line 1 only it is saying, guys. So do space C integer equals to this. I have forgot the type of the variable. Is this an input or is this an output? Right, you remember? We discussed about it just now. Okay, here you see the syntax. Input and output. I have forgot to specify whether C is my input or C is my output. See here? Remember the syntax. Okay. So I have to say this is an output parameter. So I use output. Like in functions in ABAP, you define exporting and importing. Is it possible in ABAP to write a method without defining exporting, importing, changing? Can you put a parameter without saying whether it is exporting, importing, or changing? Can you do that in ABAP? Oops, ABAP basically. You cannot. Same thing, same way. You have to say whether it's an input parameter or output parameter. It's an output parameter, C. You don't have to break the rules. No smiley here, not required. Assignment smiley is not required. Reference, it is required. Let's execute. Still some error is coming. So you see, where is the error now? SQL incorrect syntax near smiley, line number 1, column 4. At position 4, there is again some error. Equals to question mark, we had put this correctly. What is the error? Do output parameter C integer equals to question mark, begin statement, declare A equals to value, declare B equals to value, C equals to A and B. That's okay, guys. Not sure why it's giving an error. Let me try. I should not use a space, yeah? Let me try. No, it has to have a space, guys. Without which it won't work. It has to have a space. Now it's giving me some other error, I don't know. Begin declare A integer. SQL syntax, incorrect syntax near this. It's giving some error here, C integer. I need to use a space here also, I guess. No, it's not allowing me. There is some problem. So maybe I will cross-check that one, which where it's giving me the syntax error with the do condition, import-export parameters. Currently, it's not working. Maybe I will start another anonymous block. So do begin. End statement. And now inside this, what I'm going to do is I will create a database table. So I will say create table. My EMP table. So you see, guys, in this case, I am now writing a DDL statement, data declaration statement. Employee ID as in integer. And then I will write employee name as a var char and 40 character. And then I will use ID as a primary key. Typically, procedures and the containers, we don't do any DDL statements, okay? We don't do it. We majorly use for reading and calculation purpose and sometimes DML. We don't do DDL. So I created a new employee table here in the system. Now, after declaring this employee table, what I will do is I will go ahead and insert some data in this employee table. So for that purpose, I'm going to use a for loop in SQL script. So you can start a for loop, say for I in 1 to 10. That's how you start a for loop in SAP SQL script, SAP HANA SQL script. Okay. So for I in 1 to 10 do, and I'm going to insert 10 records basically, and for. That's my for loop in SQL script. So I'm going to insert 10 records, 1 to 10 I'm looping, this fixed with the counter I. Okay. And then it will insert 10 records. So I have to also declare the variable I. So declare I integer. Okay. And then I will also declare a column with employee data. So I say declare employee name as a var char, same as 40, what I want to insert. And I will default some value in this. Let's say an employee, a hard-coded value in this. I have defaulted the value in my variable. So I created an I variable for looping purpose. I've created employee name local variable. So now what I will do is I will insert a record in this employee table, which I had created. So let's say insert into my table name values. And then my first column, I will put the value of I as a key. Primary key is ID, which is an integer. So I is also a counter here, which I will use. And you see, when I'm referring, I'm using smiley, comma. And now I'll put my employee name variable. So again, you're referring, you put smiley and variable name. And in SQL script, you have a concatenation operator called double pipe. So above your enter button with shift, if you press backslash with shift, it generates the pipe operator. And then I will concatenate I with this. Okay. So that's how I will do. So this is an anonymous block which creates a database table for you, and it loops over this counter 10 times and insert 10 database records in the database table. So let's open another session and try to see if we already have some records or does this table already exist. So in SAP HANA, we have a database table called tables where we can see the list of database tables. So select star from tables. It will give you all the list of database tables in SAP HANA. So execute it. You can see these are all the list of tables and see if there is a table where table name is equals to this table name what we are planning to create, my EMP. All the database table in the tables will be in the capital letters. So my EMP, that's the name we are looking for. Okay, my EMP, you see, I will come here and execute this statement and see if I get records. Execute it. You see, there is no record in this tables, which means this table doesn't even exist in SAP HANA system. So the moment I execute my anonymous PL SQL block, it will create the database table and it would insert 10 records. The primary key is the counter and the employee name will be employee concatenated with 1, 2, 3, 4 and so on. Let's execute this block. You see, it got executed successfully. So right now, only the problem which I'm facing in SQL console is with parameters. It's not working. I need to cross-check that. But you can see now it has got executed. Let's come to the second console where we were already searching for my EMP table. Let's re-execute. And voila, you see a new table have been created in database table in SAP A4H schema. Let's look at the records of the database table, my EMP. So select star from my EMP table. Execute it and you should be my EMP table, and you should be able to look at the records. So you see there are 10 records which got inserted in your employee table. Perfect, that's what we wanted. So congratulations, this is your first productive SQL block which you had created. Whose productive SQL block you have created. Now, if I run this, will it execute anybody? If I run this block once again, will it execute or not? Will it fail or execute anyone? It will fail. Why, Shilpa? Why do you think it will fail? What is the reason your anonymous block will fail now? Absolutely correct. Your database table got already created. System would come and try to run this statement once again. The table with my EMP already exists in your current schema. System will fail this statement. Let's execute it. So you can see as error is coming. Okay. Incorrect syntax near EMP. Actually, whenever there's an error, it's showing incorrect syntax actually. But ideally, it's not syntax error. It's a issue with some code. Okay. So you see, it's giving me an error, not allowing me to create once again. Obviously, it won't because there's a table. So we will drop the table. Drop means completely remove the table from database, my EMP, and execute once again. And you see it got executed successfully. You see the table would have got recreated and the data record have been restored in the table. Now there's a question for you, those who know database. What is the difference? If you have learned about database in past, there is a statement called truncate. And there is a statement called drop. Can anybody tell me the difference between drop and truncate? This is 100% certification question if you're going for an Oracle certification. What is the difference between truncate and drop command in database? What is the difference if I apply it on a database table, truncate command and drop command? And there's also a delete command, delete database table name. What is the difference between drop, truncate and delete? Can anybody tell me quickly? You can unmute your line and tell me. Okay, Shilpa is guessing. Let me read out the answer. Data removal, complete table removal. So can you please tell me which one you are answering for which one? So what is the difference between delete, drop and truncate? Of course, so delete would delete the data. And truncate would also delete the data. I don't know. Drop will remove the table. Database, correct. Delete the DB table. Delete will delete DB table. No, Charu. Incorrect answer. Drop the table. Okay. So much of confusion. Let me come back and show you. whenever you create a database table, okay, whenever you create a database table in database system, what it does behind the scenes, it creates a structure, okay? It creates a structure in the database for this table. A structure gets created for your table in the database. This structure is known as initial extent, okay? In database, this is called initial extent, okay? It will allocate some memory to your table. Let's say 10 kilobyte or 20 kilobyte it has allocated. So what happens when you insert record? The memory will be allocated in chunks once again. So once the 20 kilobyte is filled full, next 20 kilobyte is again allocated to your database table. And again, once it is filled, next 20 kilobyte is allocated to your table. So now let's say your table initial extent, which is the structure of the table plus data, the total memory is initial extent, let's say 5 kilobyte, and then let's say three chunks got allocated of 20 kilobyte each. So 60 kilobyte total memory you have it. So you have total memory 65 kilobyte in your database for this table. Okay. When you do a delete statement, what it does, it will just erase the data from the memory, but it will not free this memory space. The memory of 65 kilobyte will still be given and allocated to the table. When you do a delete, it will just rub the data from the memory. It will not delete the memory allocated to the table. Is that clear to everybody? Delete data only, not memory. Is that clear to everybody when you do delete table? But when you do truncate table, what it does, it deletes the data plus data memory, leaving initial extent unchanged. It leaves the initial extent space, which was initial allocated for the table. Only that much will be left over. It will delete the data, basically deletes the memory. And since memory got deleted, data also got deleted. That's what your truncate does behind the scenes. Drop command, it deletes the data plus initial extent both. It removes completely both data, memory, plus initial extent. Okay. So you would even see the table structure will also disappear when you do drop command. That's the difference between delete, truncate, and drop command. If you are coming as a fresher interview to me in any technology, whether it is Java, and if there's a database question which I have to ask, this is the first question I will ask you, difference between these three commands. The first DBMS question which I will ask you for fresher interview. So you can see what will be your knowledge. What is your knowledge level currently? Because we stop learning after we get job. After we get job, we get busy in family life. We get busy with so many things, but we don't focus. We don't remember learning. Since you forget learning, your growth will stop. Not today. You will not realize it today. You will realize it after some time. Your growth will stop because you stop learning. In industry, things are changing very fast. And if you stop learning, your growth will stop over a period of time. That's the reason I personally take a lot of online courses. Just the way people don't do exercise every day, over a period of time, your body will stop functioning. So today you don't have a problem. You're fit and fine. You can eat as much as sweets, as much as junk food you want. Your body will support you. But over a period of time, the body power, stamina, strength, it will decay. And then you will get disease, sugar, high blood pressure. All the problems will come over. Health is the highest importance in the life. Please do 45 minutes of workout every day, guys. Very important. At least 45 minutes of workout. Each one of you, I recommend. Don't learn SQL script, but please do 45 minutes of workout. It will change your life. at least 45 minutes. You can walk, you can jump, you can play with your kid, you can play with friends. Very important. Health is utmost priority. Second priority, your learning. Very important. If you really want to stay in the industry and grow. With that, it's a wrap on today's class. I'm going to see you next class. We're going to talk about a lot of things. There's an issue here with this parameter for anonymous PL SQL block. We're going to talk about and fix that issue. We will discuss about while loop, if condition, case statement in SQL script. We'll talk about creating table types, arrays. We will talk about creating procedures, user-defined functions. Again, there are two different type of user-defined functions, scalar and table user-defined functions. We'll see the power of user-defined functions as compared to procedures. We will discuss about writing imperative, complex imperative logics using array functionality. We will also do procedure coding with pure declarative logic, where we will write SQL queries with declarative logic and see how will HANA execute them. It's going to be very helpful. And then finally, CE functions, we will see. We will execute CE functions and build our open item analysis scenario. So those who have joined the class recently today, please go to my YouTube channel. And there's an open item scenario which I had already discussed. Or of course, since you already subscribed, you will definitely get the information. So just search for ABAP on HANA. You're going to see my video on the top. Go to my channel. So that's my video. You can just go to my channel, and then already we have here this real-time open item scenario. Please look at the blog videos. You will get to know this. What is that we're trying to build? A real-time open item scenario is what we are building by applying all the different possible options to a code push down to HANA database. This is going to be really helpful. Towards the end of this course, I'm going to build a Fiori app using CDS View. We will build an analytical OVP Fiori app displaying amazing data in Viz Control in SAP using CDS views. That's going to be our ultimate goal with open item analysis, making Mr. Smith a happy man. So with that, it's a wrap on today's class. Please subscribe to onlinefioritrainings.com for latest trainings and updates. Thank you so much. Have a nice day and goodbye. See you tomorrow.